obviously curious with the other people, who many of whom are in this room, and I interview people with my video camera. I go around the world. I was in Israel this year in the World Economic Forum, and I try to get my audience involved in the media, in those conversations as much as possible. I use a little Nokia phone, and while I'm actually taking the interview, people can talk to me on their phone from around the world and watch that interview live, which is really cool.
Okay, but your subject matter is
anything in the tech industry.
Any kind of specialty you'd like to drill down at all?
No, I did consumer. I would say I did consumer tech.
Consumer technology.
But I've been inside. I just did HP Labs, Data Center of the Future. Anything that's interesting that's happening in the tech industry, I want to see it with the camera.
Kara Swisher, my old friend, you're on.
Okay, I do all things DA, and mostly I write about Yahoo.
We're getting to that. Do we have anyone in the room who still works for Yahoo? Okay. Thank you for coming. Welcome.
This is why.
Settle down. We're just getting going.
I am so glad that wasn't me.
I know we have a few people in the room who formerly worked.
Indeed. Yeah, okay. I can see them all here. Anyway, I write about Yahoo. Every now and then I take a slap at Mark Zuckerberg. But mostly I'm trying to write about what I did at the Wall Street Journal in the Boomtown column in this separate site that Walt Mossberg and I started. It accompanies the All Things Digital Conference. We're trying to do the same thing there, sort of bring reporting to life in a sort of a different way. We compete with the Wall Street Journal. We've had a lot of scoops compared to them too. We basically are reporting on technology, major consumer technology companies, trying to be a little bit more analytical, trying to be a little bit more, with a little more edge, I would say. I would say people would imagine our columns have a little more edge.
Than the typical fare in the Wall Street Journal.
Right, in the Wall Street Journal they have the to be sure quote, Carl Icahn might not be the best choice for us. Yahoo, to be sure, but some say perhaps he is. And I just said, oh my God, this technological nincompoop is now on the board of Yahoo. So that's the difference.
And your subject matter, Kara, beyond Yahoo and Facebook is, can you generalize?
Well, this year I'm going to focus directly on Jeff Bezos and Amazon, for example. So I can now obsess on companies the way I never could before, but it's a standardized-based news reporting system.
Right.
We're trying to bring ethics and standards the Wall Street Journal has to the blogs.
You got Snickers there, but I know you meant that completely sincerely. And I want to... More Snickers. Sorry, we're going to have to turn this way at some point.
They got the good tequila.
Before,
the guy who's laughing is the guy from Microsoft.
I did want to, real quickly, my goal for the evening is we're not going to talk about blogging because I think no one's interested in that anymore. We're going to talk about technology. But what I do want to talk about real briefly, you own Scobalizer.com, but you're an employee of Joe Mansueto, is that right? Okay, and you and News Corp owns...
Kara Swisher, I'm a wholly owned subsidiary of Rupert Murdoch.
but seriously,
I'm a wholly rented subsidiary.
and shockingly, actually liking it. I can't believe I'm saying that.
Okay, but seriously, because this sort of wonky stuff's of interest to people who think about how these companies are formed. All Things D is a wholly owned subsidiary of Dow Jones or of News Corp?
Dow Jones, which is owned by News Corp, yes. It's owned by Dow Jones, but Walt and I run a separate LLC that runs the conference and the website called Shut Up and Listen LLC.
And you're an employee of all that?
I'm an employee of Shut Up and Listen.
Great.
Walt is an employee of the Wall Street Journal.
Om, quit being so shy here. More than 30 seconds, less than 60 seconds.
I'll do it in 5 seconds.
No, I don't want that, Om.
No, I'm like Fortune only in real time.
So in real time, you bring the depth and analysis and insight that we bring every other week.
I could probably do pages. That's all I have to say.
Okay, tell us about... No, not how you really... We know how you really feel. No, so tell us what your subject matter is.
So the difference is when you have all the noise in every blog, you come and I act like you don't even know. I make sense of it all to you. Whether when Jeff's service goes down, and you say why it went down, what are the financial implications, and why you should be careful when you deploy that cloud service. So those are the three things you do. I mean, you don't have to say, you know, let Kara do the detailing. I just make sense of it all.
No, I like that. I mean, I'm glad that this is amusing, but I think that's a good description.
And anyway, it's jigom.com in case you didn't.
Yeah. But just tell me how you think about what the subject matter is. In other words, what companies and sectors of the industry are you interested in, and what are you not interested in?
I'm not interested in technology of yesterday. And absolutely no
pain. What's an example of technology of yesterday?
Computer Associates, SAP.
And so an example of a technology of today or tomorrow that you would be interested in?
Amazon Web Services, Facebook, Google.
Yahoo?
You know, Yahoo Boss, not all Yahoo. Yahoo Mail, absolutely.
Why?
Yahoo Flickr.
Why? Why Yahoo Mail?
Not everything is new. Some of it is old, so I don't care about it.
Yahoo Mail is as old as it gets at Yahoo.
No, but they're constantly reinventing.
It what? Okay.
They reinvent it. So, I actually use it, so it's pretty good. And you don't have missed messages on it.
Okay, but and at the risk of picking on you, my impression of your area of expertise is that you are
infrastructure.
Yeah, you're willing to wonk out on communications type stuff and very new Web 2.0 type companies, right? I mean, isn't that an interest of yours and your site?
Yeah. So my view of the world is anybody and everybody can hire up to the web, but when it comes to the real technology, somebody has to do it. Then that'd be me.
Okay, good. That's a point of differentiation.
Yes, and let that be him.
Okay, ownership. Explain the ownership.
I am cell phone. I have a venture-backed company.
Your venture capital firm is who?
True Ventures and a couple of angels who've been very supportive. And you know, someday perhaps some big guy will try to own it. But right now, I'm on my own.
And you have how many employees right now?
14. Yeah.
Okay, and we should just get, Om is a former member of the Fortune family. He worked at Business 2.0 and we shared an office. So just, it was a big deal in our world when he quit to start his own, he had his own thing while he was an employee of Time Inc. And then you quit to do it full time. Yeah, do we have our equities?
Where's my teeth?
No proof, no paper, you don't get nothing.
That is totally Mark Zuckerberg's argument in the Connect UK.
And it worked. So far. All right, Kara.
Yeah.
Crystal ball, I want you to tell me what's going to happen in the next 6 months at Yahoo, please.
Well, you wrote that Jerry Yang is a goner. I do not necessarily share that belief view because I believe in the quicksand lugubriousness of Yahoo moving slowly. So
did you say quicksand lugubrious?
It's lugubrious quicksand. It's more.
I don't even know what lugubrious means.
I'm Googling that.
Jeff was complimenting my vocabulary of dinner.
Well, that's everybody's looking it up, and Jerry Yang is Houston's CEO of Yahoo. I think that. They are going to stumble along. I think they are in a real situation because the new 11-member board, which I said sounds like the United Nations except less organized, is really going to have a hard time accepting if Microsoft does make a bid, which it's not going to do, make a full bid for the company. It can't accept any bid under the larger bid that Microsoft made previously, $31 to $33 a share. And so it's got to figure out what it's going to do going forward by itself, unless Microsoft comes up with some search ad deal that is, there's nothing that could come up with that Yahoo's going to say yes to, it seems like. So I think they're going to sort of stumble along. It might become clear to Jerry that perhaps he's not the right leader for the company.
Which was, my point today.
Yeah, that was your point today. The thing that you leave out is these things require logistics. Who is going to force him out? Who's going to make him leave? He doesn't really, there's no real leverage except for himself to move on. And so, you know, in a lot of these things, everyone keeps writing dream names out of Yahoo. I'm like, well, how? How's that going to?
So, all right. So play out the scenario. Tomorrow they have anywhere from an okay to horrible quarter, and
probably okay.
And you know, so and they continue to lose share, and they continue to not execute well, or maybe those are the wrong assertions.
Let me just say, correct you. They're not losing market share.
They're not.
They are losing the, you know, they're gaining market. It's not that they're just not doing well. It's just they're not doing as well as Google. In comparison, it seems like they're moving slower.
In U.S. in the share of U.S. paid search, they have lost.
Overall volume has gone up tremendously.
That's right.
Their overall.
Yeah, okay.
Which is why Microsoft is interested in it. They should be interested in it. It's a very large share of the search market, and it's, you know, one thing that's lost, and I normally talk about it, but in every post I say, this is the largest trafficked website with the best mail, so many great assets. And so, you know, it's not like a situation like that AOL was in, where it really was truly declining. It's a really vibrant asset. It has missed a lot of major shifts, and I think that they have to...
They have
to get
cares about Yahoo.
Okay, hold on. Who said that? What's your name?
Kevin Kelly
from the esteemed Kevin Kelly from Wired Magazine said, who cares about Yahoo?
Well, it doesn't matter. It's just a large multi-billion-dollar company.
I think that's a good answer. That's who cares.
It's just an interesting company.
There's so much more to talk about.
There's lots more to talk about.
Of course there is, and we're going to. But this...
Well, we wasted 10 minutes on it.
I think it's been more like 4.5. Okay, Robert, let's move on to you. So you're very... you know, you and I had a conversation at lunch today. You know, you're one of the original bloggers, actually, right? Okay. You're one of the original popularizers of blogging. You're probably best known for having been Microsoft's blogger/evangelist, right? So, you know, what are you doing today that's unique? One of the things that interests me is how active you are on Twitter and friend feed.
Yeah.
And I'm guessing some people in the room don't know about Twitter and friend feed. So let me put Kevin Kelly's question to you. Who cares?
Who cares about Twitter and friends?
Yeah, yeah, I want you to explain that.
I'd like to know what Kevin Kelly
cares about. What should we talk about, Kevin?
No, I like your idea. How many people in the room use Twitter? About 40% or so. And how about friend feed?
Who's Twittering now?
Oh, that's more
about
than I expected.
Maybe 10%.
That's more than I expected for a service that got popular in March. It's still not really popular. Twitter, it's just the way the world is communicating now among early adopters, among people who want to be connected.
At least when Twitter isn't crashing.
Yeah, and that's actually why I got so excited about FriendFeed, because FriendFeed was developed by the guy who did Gmail at Google, the guy who did Google Maps at Google, and now the guy who invented Google Talk and opened Google's Kirkman office. So it's a superstar team, 8 guys, and it's always up. I refresh it 400, 500 times a day. It's never down. Well, very rarely down. And it makes me feel good.
But I
think the real interesting thing is our usage on the internet is spreading out. I mean, when I blogged, there was no Flickr. There was no YouTube. There was no Skype. There was no any of this stuff, right? Today, I keep my event calendar over on Yahoo's upcoming.org. And I keep my photos on Flickr, and I keep some videos on YouTube, and I keep other videos, like my cell phone videos on Quick, and I keep some other videos on Kite, and I keep some other videos over on, you know, fastcompany.tv.
Your employer.
And I do blogs, and I do all sorts of stuff. I do Twitters. And so if you're going to follow me around now, you're going to follow me around a whole bunch of places. So I needed an aggregator, and there's a bunch of different ones. There's Jaiku at Google, there's Friend feed, there's...
Hold on. You're going too fast for me. What's the one at...
Jaiku.
How do you spell that?
J-A-I-K-U.
And what Google. Was this Kite thing that you mentioned?
Well, Kite is a TV thing, like, that you can use cell phones or...
How do you spell that?
I think you translate.
There's a lot out there.
I'm going to translate the Lebanese over here. What he's talking about is the idea of ubiquitous distribution. I think the idea that's really exciting for everybody, to me, I think, is the idea of ubiquitous distribution... at any point in a non-static way. I think that's what's really exciting.
Is that
now I got to translate that.
No. I mean, is that Kara? Is that the same way of saying the real-time web? Is that what you're
well,
saying?
Well, exactly. That it's that it's constantly on. It's constantly moving, and it's an ability to get. I mean, one of the reasons that we Walmart started this site is because we kept bugging the journal about how freaking slow it was, about getting, you know, when we decide to tell you about a piece of news, we'll get around to it, kind of thing.
But let me make an observation, and you know, tell me why it's an irrelevant observation. You're getting a couple hundred or a few hundred thousand visits to your blog a month, and you've got 16,000 followers on Friend Feed and 30,000 followers on Twitter. Now, those of us who are sort of interested in this stuff think of those as being really good numbers, but that's a tiny percentage of the subscription of the Wall Street Journal or Fortune or any of the other publications.
Absolutely, but the power of this isn't the large conversations. When I quit Microsoft, I told 15 people at a conference about this size, none of whom were A-list bloggers or journalists or anybody would recognize here. And in 3 days, I think Frank Shaw is here from Wagner Edstrom, I think we had 15 million media impressions in 3 days from those 15 conversations. It's the influence that is in this audience that matters. It's not the size of the original audience. It's the fact that there's a lot of journalists, a lot of bloggers in that audience that then, if they want to, can spread that idea to other audiences in other places.
So Om, I want you to jump in because you think Twitter is passé, right?
A good example of this, the video, right, I put up, just one example. I put up two videos last Monday, both done at the same company. One has 30,000 views, the other has about 500 views. Why? Because one of those videos got picked up by one of those influencers and put into an audience that had a place, a distribution place that had more audience.
So that's exactly Twitter right there, this person. Never let anybody else talk. However, the idea of Twitter was it was a group messaging platform for a select number of people. It was a real-time communications tool. Instead, it's become like this soapbox, which everybody uses, including my friend Scoble.
Well, everybody within a very narrow...
It is only a million people who use Twitter, so don't tell me that's a big audience or it's a big number. It's not. So I'm a little skeptical of it. When they get to 50 million people, I will take back my words and eat humble pie, but not until then.
Oh, hold on, let me interrupt you, because you're making money and you don't have a huge audience either, right?
No, you don't need a big audience.
So neither does Twitter.
No, but not Twitter. But that's the thing. The Twitter also has to have focus on small audiences. It used to focus on small audiences. Now it's become a Scoble radio show, pretty much.
You need to watch Twitter Vision for a while. I am one millionth of the message.
But you know, you're an extreme edge. What I'm trying to say is that we have a situation where we can actually have a very focused audience, which is what I have. My whole concept is if let everybody else be big, huge, gigantic. I want to be Gucci, BMW, Apple, applause, right? I want the right 5% people. That's why I said, in Fortune, except in real time. Because
well,
I want to get the 5% people who have the money, who are recession-proof, who will always be loyal, and who will always look for meaning in what I have to say. And there's a different approach to this, which is,
now,
the past medium was, let's go make a huge audience, let's make 50 million people, 100 million people, and then make money. Now I'm just saying, no, I can make money off 2 million people.
Now, with respect, because I want to see you succeed, there is an analog in the old print world that's called a trade publication.
Yeah.
You have a narrow, loyal audience. Other publications aim for a wider audience. They're serving a different need.
You know, Women's Wear Daily is a trade
yes.
publication. Billboard is a trade publication. And so is Multi-Channel News. Just check out their profitability. That's all I really need to say.
But I think we're trying to do something much more than that. We are trying to sort of create a new form of journalism that brings it to you in new ways. I mean, again, we were not backing away from breaking news on our site and competing with our own sister publication, The Wall Street Journal.
You're doing a better job of it.
Well,
the other thing that you're missing in the Twitter world is that it lets me listen to the audience in a way that the old world never had. Having my cell phone in, I was in a Tesla with 850
a
people
Tesla,
watching.
A Tesla, the new electric car.
I was in a long
it's on the front page of Fortune magazine.
Yeah, but I was in 5 months ago, okay? And I was in the first...
takes time to run through the printing press.
And I was in the first production Tesla with Elon Musk, the chairman of the board, and I had two cell phones. One was Jason Calacanis. He had a Corvette, and I was inside the car. I had 850 people watching on my cell phone live, reacting to what we were talking about and asking me additional questions for Elon and passing. And I was passing them on.
I think what he's saying is, what he just did in front of you was the future of marketing. Right now, he branded Jason Calacanis. He branded Tesla, he branded Quick, Skype, he just said, you didn't even realize it, those services, he evangelized that. The only other person who does a better job than him, Harrison. Seriously.
Paris Hilton. Paris Hilton. I wasn't sure what you meant.
You worked with me for 4 years, you still haven't picked up my accent. Clearly not a good reporter.
It's late, I've had a lot to drink.
You remember when she got arrested, the only thing she told the camera, I wish I could have an In-N-Out burger.
Yeah, yeah,
that was
yeah.
a pitch.
All right. I want to ask you, one more question and Kara one more question before we throw it open to this well-behaved audience here.
Keep it away from the tequila table.
We're gonna take it out of the weeds and come up a little bit. You recently wrote a post, Silicon Valley should be worried.
Yeah.
And tell us, please.
As a valley, you're trying to become a media valley, and we are very heavily dependent on advertising. And I think there were 4 or 5 signs which say things in the real world are actually not good, and the waves are crashing on Silicon Valley. I think Google had reported its numbers, and if you look at their traffic acquisition costs, they keep giving out less and less to their partners as a percentage. Overall, I don't know what the hell's going on in there. And I think there's a lot of people who would like to know and get some clarity on that whole black box called traffic acquisition cost. Microsoft admitted that their advertising business was going down. That was after spending $6 billion or so on a grant deal. I mean, that's just not even, it's less than a year ago or maybe 2 years ago. You have value inflation report that they want to cut back the numbers. And you have American Express, which is saying they're going to have more reserves for people who are going to default on credit cards. And I mean, looking at all those things, and you're looking at saying, yes, all these people, they're signs of what could be really a bigger problem. We are more and more dependent on consumer spending. We don't realize it.
You're talking about the country now or Silicon Valley companies?
The advertising run part of it.
Advertising is so huge of a part of our business. And even from the semiconductor perspective, right? We have chip guys, and what if the recession does set and hit us hard? How many iPhones can Apple sell? There will be an issue. I think there is a reality check waiting to happen. And yes, I do lie, awake at night thinking about how do you overcome that.
In your own business included. So what are you predicting? I mean, you and I both lived through the 2001 to 2003 period. It was depressing. I didn't say it was a depression. I said it was depressing.
Well, from that depressing time came Facebook and Flickr and.
But is that what you're predicting?
Absolutely.
All right, Kara. One last question before we throw it open. I'm gonna. Sort of advocate for Jerry Yang and Mark Zuckerberg here. Okay. I'd like to know, why are you so mean to them?
Oh my God, you babies, honestly. Gee, 2 multi-billionaires are frightened of me. No, I'm not mean to them. I think the 2 stories I picked when I started writing about Yahoo last year, because of blogging, I think it's helpful to be obsessive a little bit. One, I've been covering Yahoo as a consumer company for many years at the Wall Street Journal, and this was a year ago. I really started to hear from people some really troubling issues around the management there and the declines that were about to come there due to management issues. And so I think it was right to focus on leadership at that company in particular. So that's why I wrote about that. I don't think I'm mean to them. And if they think I mean to them, they are big babies. And they can take it. You know, the head of GM, when they get pilloried for trouble in the car industry, doesn't go, oh, you're so mean to me. I mean, it's kind of ridiculous to think about that. These are major multi-billion dollar public companies whose shareholders deserve their leaders having their feet held to the fire. I think that's the case.
I'm going to go ahead and say, and not everyone is agreeing with me,
yeah,
clearly.
You know, and I think that people should say what's going on.
And what about poor young Mark Zuckerberg? Why are you so mean to him?
Look, I shouldn't have called him a toddler CEO. I agree.
That was a joke. That was just
funny,
teasing.
And it was late at night, and I just typed it. I shouldn't have. But the fact of the matter is, when everybody was sort of doing the second coming of Mark Andreessen, and I see this guy smart, and he wears flip flops, and look at the little T-shirts, how cute. He's worth billions. He's a genius. That kind of stuff. I love that stuff too. I enjoy it myself. But I was really worried about the monetization issues around Facebook, and nobody was giving answers. They kept going, but look, his flip-flops are so cute. He's a billionaire. I'm like, but monetization.
It's a private company. They get to do whatever they want.
They were taking valuations of multi-billion dollar valuations, and so I thought maybe someone should maybe look into the fact that they weren't making a lot of money.
Oh, what do you want to say before we get
to that? The fact of the matter is that Carl Icahn can launch a bid, get on the board of a Silicon Valley company, tells you he's picking on the weak pieces right now. He is going to come after other companies in the valley who are equally poorly run.
Who's next, Om?
I don't understand that. That's
why not?
You've got to read the blog.
Huh? No, tell me who's next.
I'm not giving away
everything. Logical nincompoop, and that's what he is. I think Yahoo is absolutely right what it was saying about him. He's able to do this. It has a lot to do with the leadership of Yahoo, but it also has to do with an industry that has to really learn to grow up, especially with focusing on advertising.
Kara, who do you think Icahn will pick on next?
I don't think he can handle picking on someone. I think, the media sort of overblows him in terms. I think he sort of stumbles a little bit more than people realize, but I don't know. There's a lot of companies. There's a lot of companies that really need to start thinking about, what they really are, and that's like any other industry in the world. Somebody is not special. It's just fixed it.
All right, it's your turn. I've had my back to this side of the room the whole night. So, do we just have this microphone, or do we have more microphones?
There's one.
Okay, we have more. So, raise your hand. I think I see Mark Pincus in the lights there. Even though I've just said your name, stand up, tell us your name, and fire away.
It's true, I'm Mark Pincus.
You have a company that you'd like to...
Yeah,
Zynga.com.
Thank you.
I got one applause.
take what you can get.
So mean.
Mark.
That was my mom back there.
Mark is
applause. What?
Yeah, that was a child.
That was a middle child. I'm curious, as the CEO of a startup, to know who keeps the bloggers honest. So if the Wall Street Journal is talking about, we heard at the D conference about how one of the ways the Wall Street Journal is going to be more profitable is to reduce all those unneeded editors.
8.3 editors.
8.3, it's probably down to 4 now. And if people are consuming more and more of their news from professional bloggers who used to be at Fortune and Wall Street Journal, who makes sure that if there's nobody fact-checking and nobody has time, they're putting out their posts and getting it mostly right?
Yeah,
this is a question I get asked over the last 8 years, and it comes from a place of misunderstanding what is different about this internet media that we're in. This is written partly by the audience, and the audience participates in the fact-checking in live time. If I get something wrong, you should see the reaction on my comments and in my Twitter and on friend feed when I get it wrong. And if I don't correct myself, my God, my brand goes down like a rock, and nobody will invite me to be up on a stage like this ever again.
And in the old school, we like to try to get it right the first time.
Well, this is.
That's where I think the sort of, the hostility of the question
Adam,
comes from.
I'm 6 years, Microsoft will get Vista right too.
Yes. I had Tesla 5 months ago, okay?
Yeah.
To answer this question, yes, we do have the best practices of our profession in place. I do have an editor. I do censor myself. I do think before I post. I do read what I do. there is a lot of people who don't, and I don't think they will be around for a long time. Yeah. If you want to share, you want to build a sustainable business and a sustainable brand, you have to take the best practices of the past and move them forward. And I think, you know, the 8.3 is actually a point, because as a business journalist, the one thing which always bothered me was that we could criticize every single industry and their middle management, except in our own newsroom, when there were so many editors to edit one paragraph, that there were fewer reporters and more editors at a magazine. That magazine is bound to close down.
Just for the rest of you, Rupert Murdoch made a comment at Kara's conference that there were an average of 8.3 editors reading every story. I'll just point out that Fortune magazine has written about the company that owns Fortune magazine aggressively. It's not unheard of. The Wall Street Journal did an excellent job of covering Rupert Murdoch's takeover.
I mean, Mark, you know this is a great concern to me. One of the reasons that Walt and I started this site is because we looked around at a lot of the blogs and thought they were inaccurate and ethically challenged, I would say.
Right.
Very ethically challenged. And so we wrote long disclosures. If you look at our disclosures, we're trying to numb you into submission.
Yeah.
There's nothing you want to know, but we find it really important to bring standards-based Wall Street Journal reporting to blogging and to be accurate the first time.
All right, I want to come into the middle of the room here. Someone already have, yeah,
The other thing is...
Hold on, quickly, because I don't want
to
go out.
Well, I want to get to this point. The other thing is, I can publish all of my notes, which you can't in a magazine. I have all of my interviews on video, live. So you get to see my work product in a way that you never got to see in newspapers or magazines.
Yeah, we're not sure we want to necessarily subject our readers to that.
The readers out there who are passionate about the topic you write about want to see the whole thing. They don't want to see a two-minute snippet on CNN. They want to see the hour-long interview.
All right, we can agree to disagree.
Andrew McLean from Media Edge CIA, part of the WPP group of companies. If advertising is the lifeblood to much of Silicon Valley, how does the panel explain the paradox that most of the Silicon Valley properties that we see today, well, many of them were born out of what was quite good technology platforms and were not advertising platforms? Hang on. How does one get past the major stumbling point that at the moment usage is never, ever, ever going to correlate to ad revenue until the messaging background or the messaging palette, for want of a better word, engages more with usages from a commercial perspective? Now, it may be the panel's view that, you know, we didn't start out to be a commercial enterprise, so who cares? But as my esteemed colleague in the white shirt has said, he's really only interested in selling out as quickly as possible.
All right,
I think the usage of the internet and the advertising against it is not close to being the same thing. People are really using it in heavy amounts, and the advertising creative hasn't come up to it. The advertising spending has. It's all experimental. They're trying these little kind of tests and things like that. And in general, the real big money has not moved over. That's absolutely true. When that happens, and it's inevitable that this is going to happen, it will move. As we move more digitally, it will be more and more digital television, it will move that way. And away from newspapers, obviously, going down in their circulation, but move to newspaper-like websites, you know, things like that. I think the real problem is that when you go visit a lot of these Web 2.0 companies, I call it, what's your business plan? I call it advertising, comma, of course. And everybody's is advertising, comma, of course. And nobody has ad salespeople, nobody has a system in place, nobody has targeting. And so, you know, it's like a lot of people playing at being in the advertising business. And it's worrisome because you really do have to, it's just like, I mean, I'm sure Facebook will figure it out, but I want them to figure it out. But maybe they won't, I don't know.
There's hundreds of ad networks out there, though. I mean, there's one in the room right here, AdMob, that puts ads on my iPhone.
Yes, there's a lot of them. It's just, I think it's an underdeveloped industry, and there's a lot of these Web 2.0 companies that have been funded by VCs who think that all ships are going to rise, and they're just not good. It's not going to happen. We saw it in the last Web.
You know, given that I live this on a daily basis, so I think there are two answers to this question. One is Madison Avenue is still stuck in the past, where they look at the mass audiences and look at the easiest way out. You know, you might shake your head, but that is every time I go and make the sales pitch to the agency, and they say, well, if you don't have 20 million pages, why are you coming wasting our time? Because that's their argument, is that they want 20 million people and not focusing. And I think there needs to be some heavy innovation on the Madison Avenue side of things. And I'm not saying they're not thinking about it, but that has to happen. They have to come to the reality of a niche audience. And I think that is a big challenge. It's a mindset challenge more than anything else. Technology is not an issue. The second issue is, from our perspective, from a startup perspective, if you look at it, we have to do exactly what Kara said. We have to build put sales processes and advertising sales teams in place. I go make sales pitches with my team. I have a chief operating officer who does that on a daily basis. It is not easy to build a business. As my friend, Vivek Shah knows, selling, doesn't matter how big a brand you might be, selling an online property is not easy. And I think from that perspective, Silicon Valley is a bit delusional, because I don't think we are a media entity. We are not a media valley. We used to invent chips and make routers and make pipes and do things what Jeff is doing right now. Now we are making websites, which sell something about something.
Let me make two observations. We still make chips and routers and software and pipes. We still make a lot of it. My view on this topic is that this debate will cease sometime in the next 10 years, and all media companies will sell all of these media, and this conversation will be looked back on as having been quaint. But I want to thank the three of you for coming up and having me with us today.